This is Common Sense Radio. Straightforward and no excuses.
All right. Come on now.
This is the Steve Gruber Show.
Call me crazy.
Ooh, yeah.
What I said was perfectly right and spot on accurate.
Boy's got a mouth like a cannon, always shooting it all.
Stop. Yeah, stop. I mean, you're way off script.
Got it in me. Gonna quit until it all comes out.
Hey, boy.
Yeah, you know, it's not cynical, it's common sense.
Pay attention to me when I'm talking to you.
I'm gonna rock the nation.
Genuine, accountable, and raw. Here is Steve Gruber.
Thursday, and welcome to it, my friends. The Steve Gruber Show, ready to get rolling. Gonna need your help today. The phone number is 888-900-9966, 888-900-9966. I can tell you that the protests you've seen thus far against Donald Trump are mild in comparison to what's coming. We have three big stories today. That's one of them. We're also going to talk about Barack Obama's pick of Judge Merrick Garland, an anti-gun justice from the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. Yet another Harvard grad, another guy from the same court system. What is that, 8 or 9 of the justices that'll be from Harvard if he gets confirmed, I suppose, which isn't likely. And then Governor Snyder will be testifying today in Washington on the water crisis. But let's start with the Democracy Spring. That's what it's being called by the organizers, created by George Soros, the European-born billionaire who will do anything to promote Marxism, who will do anything to attack Republicans and promote the agenda of Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton. It's all coming, and it's getting little fanfare, almost no news media coverage. But the same radical groups in shutting down Donald Trump's Chicago rally last week are plotting a mass civil disobedience movement to begin very soon. They intend to march across the East Coast in order to spark what they call a fire that transforms the political climate in America. The operation, like I said, is calling itself Democracy Spring. It's threatening drama in Washington with the largest civil disobedience action of the century. The radicals believe this will result in the arrest of thousands of their own activists. Here's part of it from their website. We will demand that Congress listen to the people and take immediate action to save our democracy, which we don't even have, but they're too stupid to realize it. And we won't leave until they do, or until they send thousands of us to jail. The group is backed by numerous organizations, but again, the key person behind it and the funding is George Soros and MoveOn.org. Yeah. MoveOn.org has been playing a prominent role in organizing anti-Trump activism, including the attack on the University of Illinois Chicago. Another group endorsing Democracy Spring is the Democratic Socialists of America. The DSA and the Chicago branch drove protesters to the weekend event in Chicago. The AFL-CIO, the nation's largest labor union, announced in a press release earlier this month that it is all in behind Democracy Spring. And next month's Democracy Spring is set to begin April the 2nd at the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia. That is a Saturday. Then in the spirit of Granny D, the Selma to Montgomery marchers, Cesar Chavez, and the farm worker pilgrimage, and others who walked for freedom, we will set out on a 10-day 140-mile march from Philadelphia to the nation's capital, states the website. In Washington, D.C., Democracy Spring expects thousands of Americans to engage in a sit-in in the Capitol building in what will be the largest civil disobedience action of the century. What do they want? Well, despite the fact that many of the main groups endorsing Democracy Spring are funded by billionaire Soros, the group complains that American elections are dominated by billionaires. Of course, they're, again, too dumb to realize that the ones that are sourcing their money are also billionaires, ones that aren't even from this country. Soros is what, Romanian? Big money interests who can spend unlimited sums of money on political campaigns to protect their special interests and at the general expense. Here's one of their postings, if you will. If the status quo goes unchallenged for the 2016 election, already set to be the most billionaire-dominated, secret money-drenched, voter suppression-marred contest in modern American history, will likely yield a president and a Congress more bound to the masters of big money than ever before. The stage is set for a bold intervention to turn the tinder of massive public frustration into a fire that transforms the political climate of America, that sparks a popular movement that can't be stopped. It continues with, we will demand that Congress listen to the people and take immediate action to save our democracy. Again, it's not a democracy. And we won't leave until they do, or until they send thousands of us to jail. Along with the unmistakable message that our country needs a new Congress, one that will end the legalized corruption of our democracy and ensure that every American has an equal voice in government. Whatever all that means. The leaders of the group have already held training sessions, the website says. Democracy Spring states it is requiring mandatory nonviolent civil disobedience trainings twice a day for those risking arrest between April 11th and April 16th. For those arrested, the group says it has already secured the legal aid of an unnamed lawyer with decades of experience with civil disobedience cases. He is leading a team of pro bono lawyers who will provide legal counsel and representation for all participants who risk arrest as part of this campaign. Democracy Spring is threatening drama in Washington that cannot be ignored, with hundreds of patriotic Americans being sent to jail day after day for at least a week simply for sitting in to save our democracy. The drama in Washington will rock the business-as-usual cycle of this election and catapult the critical issue onto center stage. Well, thankfully, hopefully, it will, because I think it's about time that we put these liberal fascists in a spotlight. It's time that people like ABC News and NBC News and CBS News stop ignoring what's going on. Stop blaming Donald Trump for the rise of liberal fascism in America. You don't have to like Donald Trump, but to suggest that somehow the assaults on his gatherings are his fault is, well, it's ridiculous. It's disingenuous. It's intellectually dishonest. And a whole host of other things. And you don't have to be a Trump supporter to realize, you don't have to support Donald Trump in any way to realize what's happening there is a setup, that he is being gamed, and that the media is going right along with it and showing images to support the narrative that somehow Donald Trump is a racist, Donald Trump is xenophobic, and Donald Trump is, you know, upsetting all of these people, and therefore they have to come shut down his rallies. Well, there are rules for this, but I don't believe it to be true. We will use no violence. We maintain an attitude of openness and respect towards all we encounter. We will not destroy or damage property. We will not carry weapons. We will not wear masks or conceal our identities. We will exercise personal and collective, there's the word, responsibility to ensure we adhere to this agreement. Despite the involvement of the groups active in opposing Trump, Democracy Springs website does not mention Trump by name. But make no mistake, the campaign director of Democracy Spring interrupted the GOP debate, saying American people deserve free and fair elections, not billionaire auctions. They're all in this together. More after this on the Steve Gruber Show.
Taking a closer look at the stories that affect you most with a big dose of common sense.
Get back to Democracy Spring a bit later, but Merrick Garland, Judge Merrick Garland, put forth by Barack Obama yesterday as his pick to fill the vacancy left by the death of Antonin Scalia. Well, Merrick Garland would threaten gun rights, according to everybody who's looked at his judicial record. He has two spot-on, on-point cases. Both times, President Obama has nothing but contempt for the Second Amendment and law-abiding gun owners, says Chris Cox, head of the National Rifle Association's Institute for Legislative Action. Obama is basically sticking his thumb right in the eye of the Republicans who say they're not going to do it. Well, I hope Mitch McConnell is not going to do it. They can call them obstructionists. They can call them. They can do whatever they want. The Constitution of the United States requires the Senate to advise and consent. Well, if the advice is withdraw the nomination, then you've gotten your advice, Mr. President. And they have been completely constitutional and followed the rule of law. You see, it wasn't just the president getting elected that has consequences. The president being disliked so much that the United States Congress was overtaken in record numbers by Republicans also has consequences. Let's hear a little bit. Here's a bit of what Obama had to say in nominating Merrick Garland. Clip one, go.
Of the many powers and responsibilities that the Constitution vests in the presidency, few are more consequential than appointing a Supreme Court justice, particularly one to succeed Justice Scalia, one of the most influential jurists of our time. The men and women who sit on the Supreme Court are the final arbiters of American law. They safeguard our rights. They ensure that our system is one of laws and not men.
Yeah, and as long as the Senate follows the Constitution, it is a nation of laws and not the arrogance of men. You're right about that, Mr. President. Moments later, Merrick Garland, the federal appeals court judge, spoke on his own behalf. Clip two, go.
As my parents taught me, by both words and deeds, a life of public service is as much a gift to the person who serves as it is to those he is serving. And for me, there could be no higher public service than serving as a member of the United States Supreme Court. Trust that justice will be done in our courts without prejudice or partisanship is what in a large part distinguishes this country from others. People must be confident that a judge's decisions are determined by the law and only the law. For a judge to be worthy of such trust, he or she must be faithful to the Constitution and to the statutes passed by the Congress. He or she must put aside his personal views or preferences and follow the law, not make it. If the Senate sees fit to confirm me to the position for which I have been nominated today, I promise to continue on that course. Mr. President, it's a great privilege to be nominated by a fellow Chicagoan. I am grateful beyond words for the honor you have bestowed upon me.
All right, and then Mitch McConnell quickly responding. The Senate Majority Leader, Republican, says the American people must have a voice in filling the Supreme Court vacancy. Simply put, nothing's going to happen until there's an election. Clip three, go.
Mr. President, the next justice could fundamentally alter the direction of the Supreme Court and have a profound impact on our country. So, of course, the American people should have a say in the court's direction. It is the President's constitutional right to nominate a Supreme Court justice, and it is the Senate's constitutional right to act as a check on a President and withhold its consent. As Chairman Grassley and I declared weeks ago and reiterated personally to President Obama, the Senate will continue to observe the Biden rule so that the American people have a voice in this momentous decision. The American people may well elect a president who decides to nominate Judge Garland for Senate consideration. The next president may also nominate somebody very different. Either way, our view is this. Give the people a voice in filling this vacancy.
Yep, that's good.
The Senate.
That's good. That's exactly right. So they're not going to take it up is the point. The other big story of the day on this is St. Patrick's Day, by the way, that I failed to mention, but happy St. Patrick's Day. But the Flint water crisis is the result of a state-appointed emergency manager's decision to use the Flint water as a water source and state regulators' decision not to require treatment to make the water less corrosive. So says the chief of the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, which is a complete an utter lie. State regulators didn't require or not require treatment of the water. That was from the Flint Water Department. In violation of federal law, I might say. But that is what Gina McCarthy wrote in testimony to the House Committee on Oversight and Government Reform. She's scheduled to appear today, as is Governor Rick Snyder, before that panel. These decisions, she said, result in Flint residents being exposed to dangerously high levels of lead. Well, not true. Not true at all. Governor Snyder did release a transcript of what he is going to say today. A failure of government at all levels, local, state, and federal. We all failed the families of Flint, he says, in part. And we'll get to more of that in a moment. But first, we're going to go to the hotline. Dave is on the hotline in Diamonddale. Dave, welcome to the program. We've got about 30 seconds. Dave, are you there?
Yes. Sorry. I was just turning my volume on my phone up.
That's right.
This kind of goes back to yesterday a little bit, but I was talking about the president saying that the Senate needs to do their job, because that's what the Constitution says, which, of course, it doesn't. But I think somebody needs to remind the populace that Harry Reid sat on bill after bill after bill that the House sent him, and he wouldn't act on any of them.
Yeah, but here's the thing. That was never reported on. The liberal media never reported on any of that. Everybody's in the dark. They have to do their own looking and thinking, and so therefore it's a problem, Dave. You're right, but we're never going to hear about it. Back in a moment on the Steve Gerber Show.
Delivering Michigan common sense with a big dose of truth and honesty.
You're pushing too hard, you're pushing on me. You're pushing too hard on what you want me to be. You're pushing too hard about the things you say. You're pushing too hard every night and day. You're pushing too hard.
All right, it's 33 after the hour. Democracy Spring Rising. Another way to put that is liberal fascism rising in America. You see, every time one of these groups goes and attacks free speech and is cheered on, you get a little bit closer to totalitarianism. You get closer to fascism. You know, your safe spaces and your hate speech and don't say anything because I might be offended takes us a little bit closer. And with the rise of fascism at the behest of George Soros to shut down political events because they don't like, you know, what the guy has to say or the woman has to say, or they don't like the professor. This has gone on too far. It's gone too far. It's gone on too long. Our next guest, Aubrey Shines, Glory to Glory Ministries. Aubrey, welcome back.
Always great being with you, Steve. Thanks for having me.
So it's interesting that this Democracy Rising thing powered by the billionaire George Soros is going to put apparently tens of thousands of people in the street beginning April 2nd here. In an effort to shut down Washington and get thousands arrested, and yet there's not a peep about it in the national media. Not a peep. No, they just keep harping on how Donald Trump said something obnoxious, so therefore he created this violence. He didn't create the violence. He didn't bring thousands of people to his own protest to disrupt it, obviously. But I just wonder, how dumb are people anyway?
It's scary, Steve, to me. I tell you why, because you never, ever, ever seen any of us conservatives go to any rally of any sort, Hillary, Bernie, and protest and scream someone down. You don't, and you won't hear any peep out of the media because the media is complicit with it. Remember, 91% of all of our major media outlets, according to their own statistics, they are left in their ideological philosophy. As a result of that, the only way that they can really kind of get their words over is continue to amplify the very thing that they say that they're opposed to, and that is people having choices. Unless, of course, the people that have choices are people like myself that don't go along with their narrative. And as a result of it, we are screamed and we're shot down because of it.
Well, here's the thing. And, you know, I wrote a column a month ago now that, I believe that we got Ronald Reagan as a direct result of the failures of Jimmy Carter. And I thought that we might get something good as a result of having to put up with Barack Obama for two terms. But instead, what we got is a whole group of people that are rising on the left because they don't like what he did either. You know, Barack Obama's failures as a president are seen on both sides for different reasons, but his overall failure as a leader is evident by the rise of Democracy Spring, by the rise of Donald Trump, by the rise of Bernie Sanders. I mean, there's just no question about it from where I stand.
No, I'm with you. I'm 100% with you. I've been screaming this for 7.5, 8 years, that this is what you are going to get. I screamed to the clergy across this nation, especially those that were 100% supporters. And Steve, I really do have a lot of friends that have what's called mega churches. And these guys, I was screaming, I was warning, I was saying, look, I'm a Chicago guy. I can tell you who Dr. Jeremiah Wright was. I can tell you who Dr. Cones, who trained Jeremiah Wright. I can tell you that this guy is going to do everything that is going to be anti-American. He's going to violate your trust. And, of course, now these guys have what I call, you know, a buyer's remorse as a result of it. But we
But they
angry.
Won't admit it. But they won't admit it, by and large, these people, pastors at mega churches. You know, because you always see the community leaders of these black pastors will come out and they'll almost 100% of the time, Aubrey, except for maybe you, which makes you the exception to the rule, they're always in support of these Democratic policies. You look what happens in Flint, Michigan. There's a water crisis. Blame the Republicans. Those evil Republicans were poisoning black children, which, of course, is not true. And the fact that it would come out of anybody's mouth is reprehensible. And the fact that they would believe that, they would believe that a fellow human being, regardless of party affiliation, would actually target a small child for poisoning because they're black. I mean, how does this even come out of somebody's mouth?
Well, you first of all, you have to have a deranged mind to have it to come out of your mouth. I wrote and been speaking out against the issue there in Michigan as well, saying this is absurdity that has gone wild. This is the craziest thing in the whole wide world to hear someone try to blame someone. And when I see the race baiters, whether it's Jesse Jackson, Al Sharpton, Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, all of them are the same Steve ilk. In my opinion. And what happens in a nutshell, and I'm asked this question every week, and that is, well, why is it that blacks and why is it that, you know, you have these large groups of people that are continuing to believe this stupid narrative? And I say it's simple. When 91% of all of your download of news comes from left-winging media outlets, but you don't know that they're left-winged. You don't know. You just assume you're putting on a news station, and some kind of way you're getting the information that you need to get. That's, you know, should be fair and balanced, and you're not.
But
Steve,
sometimes
you continue to believe this stupidity.
Yeah, they camouflage it pretty well sometimes. For example, you know, the liberals and those camouflage their beliefs pretty well. For example, Merrick Garland comes out with the president yesterday. Sounds like a reasonable, you know, middle of the road guy. But then you do a little bit of research, he's hardly reasonable. He's certainly not middle of the road on a lot of things that people hold dear in this country. But he sounds reasonable. So when people hear news and they get the same sort of, you know, the cloaking of the truth, well, then, you know, they swallow something not realizing they've been given a poison pill, if you will.
Oh, yeah, yeah, and I've been screaming against this inequality that has been going on for a long time. When I'm on your show, Stephen, I'm not exaggerating. I can't tell you how many positive results I have gotten just from being on your show, because we'll upload you guys and send it back out again. I have people in Michigan listening to you, never heard of you. Why? Not because you guys weren't doing a good job. You guys have been cloaked in this false narrative up there. No one wants to know, or no one wants to hear, rather, that there are some voices that actually sound reasonable and logic in the things that you guys are doing. I'm telling you, you're making an impact. And I beg you, as an American citizen, please don't stop doing what you're doing. You are making a difference in your area. And that's just not flattery. I can read you emails that I get as a result of it.
Well, I appreciate that. And we do sit here. We carry the flag, and we do what we do because, you know, I believe that often days that we give a voice to the silent majority. We give a voice to the silent majority, and you're right, because we're outgunned financially by big networks. But the truth of the matter is, a lot of folks just don't speak up anymore because they don't want to be called a racist. They don't want to be labeled and attacked and insulted, and they don't want rent a riot at their place of business, right? They don't want these people showing up and creating big disturbances with them. So they go about their business, but they also vote. So let me ask you, what do you think is going to happen? I know you're a Cruz guy.
Yeah, I am.
And Rubio's gone. Kasich is sticking around for his own arrogance, apparently, because he has no chance of winning anything.
Yeah, he's a petulant child. That's all he is.
Yeah. Another radio host, Glenn Beck, said some much stronger things about him yesterday that I saw. But anyway, what do you think is going to happen now with this going forward? Does Trump still garner enough? Can Cruz rally?
I don't think so. I really do not think so. And even though if you listen to every major media outlet, they've all but given him the coronation. I mean, and those are considered conservatives as well. They've just kind of automatically said. But I don't think at this point that we should throw in the towel, those of us like myself that are Cruz guys, because I do not think this is over. I think moving forward, we're going to see it. I do wish that the petulant child, Kasich, would get out of it. He has no mathematical probability of getting there. And I think if you see a two-man race, notice something, Trump will not debate Cruz now one-on-one. There's a reason for it. He can't win.
No, it'd be, well, Cruz is a grandmaster debater, you know. I wouldn't want to debate him either. And I'm not bad, and you're not bad either. Pastor Aubrey Shines, always a pleasure.
Thanks again, Steve.
There you have it. Pastor Aubrey Shines, founder of Glory to Glory Ministries in Florida. Keep it coming, my friends, and fight the good fight every day. It's the Steve Gruber Show.
Michigan, born and raised with Midwestern values and Michigan common sense.
All right, be careful out there today. It is St. Patrick's Day. You know, I've got some good friends of mine, Irish Catholics, God bless them. And they were of the opinion that, you know, if there wasn't beer in the world, the Irish would be running everything. Irish would be in charge of everything if not for beer. The contention of my friends who are Irish, of course. If you're looking for room to grow a new home in the country, might be right for you, but with so many construction choices, how do you know which options offer the best value? Well, Greenstone FCS is here to help. The week of March 21st, that's next week, Greenstone is holding a series of educational seminars on new home construction, probably in your area. Industry experts will cover a range of subjects, including how to make selections that add value to your home, being your own contractor, and paths to financing your project. To learn more and to register, visit greenstonefcs.com/seminar. That's visit greenstonefcs.com/seminar. And by the way, I'm a Greenstone customer. A good partner for me for a very long time. So I'm back to this Democracy Spring and why nobody is talking about this. If these protesters who claim to be nonviolent, which we've clearly seen they are not nonviolent, continue to shut down political events, at what point does the left realize that they're going to get shut down as well? Bernie Sanders has had his events shut down by some of these groups. Hillary Clinton has had hecklers and people try to shut down her events by some of these groups. You know, at what point do people realize that you can cheer them on when they're attacking your opponent, if you're so inclined? But how long does it take before you become their opponent? How long does it take before you become their opponent? And when you do, are they going to shut you down? And the answer is, of course they are. Because at some point, they turn on every message until they have a very narrow conversation. Just something for you to consider because, you know, you can sit there and cheer them on as long as they're attacking somebody else. But make no mistake, that kind of beast only feeds on that kind of power and it gets stronger. And therefore, liberal fascism rising in America is nothing to be taken lightly. I really believe that. Here's a little story about Obamacare that I thought you would find interesting. And I go back to Consumers Mutual Insurance here in Michigan, which was a co-op, the only one in Michigan, that was my insurance company for a period of time. I really liked them. I thought they were pretty decent, but they were created by the government. And then they were destroyed and defunded by the government because they couldn't sustain financially. Well, here's something for you to consider. 34 top executives at 10 failed Obamacare co-ops, paid a combined $8.2 million in 2014, according to tax returns that were obtained by the Daily Caller. New York had the highest total. It paid four of its employees $1.15 million. The Health Republic Insurance of New York CEO, Deborah Friedman, taking in $427,000, and Chief Operating Officer Nicholas Liguori, $316,000. Nevada Health Cooperative CEO had the highest salary of the year at $428,001. I wonder how you did that $1. At any rate, the point being is your tax dollars were papering the nest of these folks of co-ops. And then it just went away. Despite the mass failure, Hillary Clinton called for more nonprofit health insurance providers during a recent CNN Democratic town hall get-together. Here's what she said. You know, Blue Cross and Blue Shield used to be nonprofits, and then they transferred themselves into for-profit companies. And there was some effort made under the Affordable Care Act to get some competition from nonprofit institutions. Some of them worked, and a lot of them didn't. I want to know what we can do, because if we could get a range of insurers, some of who were not-for-profit companies, that would lower costs. Lower costs, really. Because Obamacare, the rate increases this year for many people are 30 to 40%, some even higher. Premium increases for people across this country, in many cases this year, 30 to 40%. Not to mention people like myself have been kicked off from our insurance companies. I mean, I've lost two insurance companies since this all began. I was told I could keep my insurance. I've lost two so far. And the confusion continues, because every time you go back to your doctor and you have to go, do you have a new insurance? Yes, so you got to start over and do all the paperwork, and you go to pick up a prescription and you forget, well, gosh, I have to, you know, do that again because it's different and it takes extra time, and it's a hassle. Of course, the government doesn't care if it's a hassle. You know, we're going to get back to the good old days when you stand in line for 3 or 4 hours just to get some license plates for your car. Well, as long as cars are legal, before they make cars illegal, outlaw cars. Because how dare you have, personal transportation? What are you, arrogant? What are you, rich? Anybody that has a car must be too rich. We should tax them more. All right. And let's see here. One more thing I want to get to before we get to the break here. Wayne County Prosecutor Kim Worthy, very upset yesterday, blasting Genesee County, claiming that former Michigan State basketball star Mateen Cleaves was provided a clandestine backdoor arraignment. Cleaves arraigned yesterday by Genesee District Judge Kathy Dowd on multiple felony charges, including counts of unlawful imprisonment and criminal sexual conduct. Worthy's office claimed Cleaves and his attorney were expected to appear in court today for the arraignment. However, Worthy claims her office was given short notice. The hearing was moved to Wednesday morning to quickly get him in and out because he's a local hero. Well, we'll see. He's facing a lot of charges and just an unfortunate situation for Mateen Cleaves on this day, the day that March Madness truly begins on this day, St. Patrick's Day, 2016. You're listening to The Steve Gruber Show.
This is Common Sense Radio. Straightforward and no excuses.
All right. Come on now.
This is the Steve Gruber Show.
Call me crazy.
Oh, yeah.
What I said was perfectly right and spot on accurate.
Boy's got a mouth like a cannon, always shoot for the hole.
Stop. Stop. I mean, you're way off script.
Got it in me. Gonna quit until it all comes out.
Hey, boy.
Yeah, you know, it's not cynical, it's common sense.
Pay attention to me when I'm talking to you.
I'm gonna rock the nation. Rock the nation.
Genuine, accountable, and wrong. Here is Steve Gruber.
I think the reason that I got into broadcasting, television, and radio in the first place, I like telling stories. And I like hearing great stories, and I like, talking to people that are the focus themselves of great stories. And I think that's what the thread that brought me to broadcast to do what I do here today. And my next guest, I believe, has an incredible story, but it took a turn here recently. Let me read from the homepage of her website, Dr. Carol Swain. From high school dropout and teenage mother to highly accomplished university professor and public intellectual, Dr. Carol M. Swain is passionate about empowering others to confidently raise their voices in the public square. Dr. Swain's education and experiences make her a credible and powerful force for change in today's social and political climate, where conservatives are intimidated to champion an often unpopular message. Invite her to speak at your next event and visit her website at bethepeopletv.com. Incredible story. Born in segregated Virginia, the second of 12 children, she grew up sharing a bed with her sisters in a shack, frankly, that had no running water. Her family's so poor, she had no shoes and had to stay home from school when the weather was bad, so she never did make it to high school. Dr. Carol Swain, I'll leave that as our foundation. Welcome to the program.
Good morning. It's a pleasure.
It's a pleasure to have you on the program, and your accomplishments took you all the way to being a professor at Vanderbilt University. And from very, to say humble beginnings, I don't think does justice to your story. But give our listeners just a little bit of the background of where you grew up. It was segregated Virginia. It was a different time.
It was segregated Virginia, and my accomplishments, and I'll say God actually took me first to Princeton University, and that was where I was tenured. I started my career there, and I was there for about 10 years, and then I accepted the job at Vanderbilt. And so I have gone far from a woman that was born, you know, as a child raised in rural poverty.
And in a different time, a different place in America, where segregation was the order of the day.
I was born in the 1950s, and the public schools in Virginia were integrated in the late 60s, early 70s. And so I started a public school in a segregated setting.
Well, and I want to get back to that in a minute, but I want to fast forward to the main reason that you ended up on my radar, if you will, how you caught my attention and why I think your story is so important today. As we hear about these groups like Democracy Spring and Black Lives Matter and all these other groups that are demanding social justice, if you will, about 1,400 students at Vanderbilt a few months ago signed a petition demanding that you take diversity training or be terminated because apparently your background and that you're a conservative, you obviously are too insensitive. This petition came from a guy named Nick Goldbach, some white hipster kid, described as an urban enthusiast who apparently learned his all the things in his life from a sustainable luxury resort in Connecticut that taught him about common humanity, I guess. I mean, this is what I've understand. Am I, you laughing, but that's what it says.
Yes.
And he apparently cares about civil rights and social action. And you, Professor, apparently your background and your upbringing and your life don't rise to the level of liberalism that he demands. It's absurd.
Just the students. I was told that a faculty member had argued before the faculty senate that I should not camp for diversity purposes because I did not hold the right views on gender equality and the issues that were important to the political left. The person that related the story to me said her response was, how can you get any more diverse than a conservative black woman on the Vanderbilt campus?
That's a fine point. I mean, you're kind of on an island all by yourself, aren't you?
Yes, but with the students, what triggered their attack on me was January 2015, after the Charlie Hebdo attack, I wrote an opinion piece that was critical of radical Islam. And the Muslim students complained, but the university also sent out a campus-wide email criticizing my opinion piece and offering the students that needed it counseling, as well as encouraging them to engage in expressive freedom of expression and dialogue. And so for me, freedom of expression is code word for protest. And so there was this massive protest that preceded the petition that came some months later. And when the petition was started, part of that had to do with something I had posted on Facebook that offended the students that were reading my Facebook page.
Let me ask you this. Let's go back now. This is how I'm going to put this together. Let's go back to segregated Virginia when you were a girl and you were growing up. I'm going to guess in the 1950s and 60s, you were the focus on occasion of overt racism. I would assume, right or wrong?
We were so poor that it was not something that you even noticed. I remember an incident in the 1960s where a man called my brother over, and he gave him a dime, and he said, "You all can't say that we aren't good to you." And now, obviously, that had tons of meaning. But back then, you know, we were watching on television the civil rights movement, but our day-to-day lives, we were not involved in those discussions.
My point being this, though. You didn't need counseling because you were raised poor. You didn't need counseling because somebody tried to hurt your feelings or gave your brother a dime or whatever the case may be. Apparently, you writing a column that some closed-minded liberal finds, you know, distasteful or not to their opinion. They need counseling. I mean, I'm sorry.
What? I mean, that's the way it is on college campuses now. You know, they all need safe spaces, and they expect us to issue trigger warnings before we say anything that might be offensive to a whole slew of groups. And I actually refuse to cooperate with that. In my classroom, the rules are very clear that it's a free speech zone, and we have norms of civility, but there are no topics that are really off limits. And I tell students on the first day, if they're overly sensitive, that my classroom is not a safe place for them to be. And so I encourage them, you know, to make a decision for that comfort level. If they don't want to be challenged by the ideas, then they really shouldn't be taking my courses, which are electives.
So real quickly, before we hit the break here, what are your courses? Then we're going to talk about a few other things. What do you teach?
I teach an undergraduate course on political culture, and right now I'm teaching a law class on religious liberty.
All right, hold right there. Dr. Carol Swain, great story, and a great, I don't know, it's a great illumination of what's going wrong with the liberal youth, these little petulant fascists, frankly. I'll back in a moment on the Steve Gruber Show. Sit tight.
Keeping you in touch with Michigan and the world.
I began to find myself searching.
All right, welcome back. Steve Gruber Show on a Thursday, having a great conversation with Dr. Carol Swain. But first, we're going to go to David. He's listening online in California today with a comment before we go on. David, welcome to the program. What's on your mind?
Excuse me. Yeah, morning, Steve and Doctor. You know, I was interested in what a true conservative is. And, you know, when you look at something like Flint, Michigan's water, that's not a political issue. That's a scientific issue. And I'm just wondering, you know, I've been listening around for Michigan stations talking about the governor coming on C-SPAN this morning trying to explain himself, and he's trying to, I bet he's going to weasel around with market forces, and it's too expensive to let these people drink clean water. Mm-hmm. And this was one of those campaign issues.
Well, David, I appreciate you calling in, but that's really not on topic. And David, I appreciate you calling in. That's not what we're talking about right now. You can call back a little bit later, and I can explain to you why the governor has become the victim of a political witch hunt as well. No problem. Dr. Carol Swain back with us now, a professor at Vanderbilt, also went to Princeton, raised in a segregated family, a poor family in Virginia, and has risen to the highest echelons of academia. But I'm going to guess, Doctor, you don't find much refuge in the teacher's lounge at Vanderbilt. You're probably mostly by yourself.
No, excuse me. What has happened is that all the controversy has brought me more support, and I'm expecting the Faculty Senate to present to the university a resolution for free speech and academic freedom.
And wouldn't that be great?
Well, the thing is that the attacks that came on me could easily someday be turned against other people. And so I think that my colleagues realize that we all have a vested interest in free speech.
Well, you know, you know what's sad? What's sad to me, Doctor, is to hear you say that we have to have an act of the university senate or whatever to promote freedom of speech. I mean, what was this country founded on? It's the free exchange. It's the marketplace of ideas.
And well, the universities across the country are so intimidated by radical student groups that the administrators cave, and they've done it so many times that I believe that various members of the faculty, political left as well as conservatives, see that we have a dangerous situation, and we're also cheating our students out of an education. Their parents are paying, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars to educate students that are coming out, you know, as little wimps that can't participate in a conversation without withering.
Yeah, well, and that's the problem. We have all these, as you know, you see students come out of universities that have been there for however much time, spent all this money, have all this debt, and they didn't learn anything. you know, they didn't learn anything about the way the world works. They're offended and they can't find a job, and they're we've created a bunch of thin-skinned, entitled, petulant children, and I think that's unfortunate. Am I wrong about that?
I mean, it's true, but also I am encouraged by the students that are in my courses, especially the undergraduates, in the sense that they sought me out, and they're not all conservative students, that most of them are liberal students, but they were not in agreement with the protests and harassment I experienced last year, and they want to talk about the issues in our country. So I think that it was a small minority with a megaphone. And if you go back to Saul Alinsky's strategies, one of the strategies, if your group is small, you make a lot of noise. And if it's so, if it's tiny, you know, tiny, you stink up the place. And so the students attacking me were making a lot of noise, and they were stinking up the place.
Yeah, and they certainly did, and that's unfortunate. But I'm glad to hear that there are students out there, even liberal students, that are willing to give you a fair hearing, that they're not all, you know, snowflakes, withering flowers, if you will. It's good to know that the free exchange of ideas, because some of the most vigorous discussions I've had in my life are with people that are far left of center, and we have great discussions. And we don't, you know, drop to, you know, personal insults. We have vigorous discussion, which is what it's supposed to be.
Well, the students attacking me were not students who had ever been in any of my classes. And so that's a factor. And the political culture class has always had a waiting list. And so that's how popular it is. And I've always taught it as a free speech zone.
Yeah. And so what about the column on radical Islam and the dangers to the Western world? Apparently, I'm going to guess you still stick to those tenets.
I do. In fact, if you read my column today, it doesn't seem so extreme because it was written after the first Charlie Hebdo attack, and that was before the shootings in Chattanooga, San Bernardino, and the second Paris attack.
Right. So when you look out there today and you see these groups that are, you know, Democracy Springs says it's going to shut down Washington, D.C., and Black Lives Matter, and the thousand people from George Soros that descend on Donald Trump get-togethers, whether you like Trump or not, them shutting down free speech and their way of organizing these riots, if you will, what are your thoughts?
I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged because I think it's going to backlash big time, just like it did in the 1960s, and that they're setting the stage for a wave of conservatism and law and order, because at some point, the American people, you see that they've reached the point where they're not going to take anything and everything. And so I believe that the political left has overplayed its hand and it's in the process of doing so. So,
Last question, and I think that's a great answer, and I hope you're right, Doctor. We've got about 30 seconds here, but if in that time, can you sum up the presidency of Barack Obama over the last 7 years from where you stand?
I think it's been a disaster, and it's worse than race relations in America. And I believe that if people are honest, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, you can see that, you can know that. And when I think about, you know, the potential of a Trump presidency,
yeah.
I think that nothing could be as bad as what we have experienced.
And I greatly appreciate it. Dr. Carol Swain, I will say you are an inspiration. Your story is terrific. Your attitude is just incredible. And I'm glad you're on the program. I'd like to have you again.
Thank you so much. Looking forward to it.
Dr. Carol Swain, if that's not an inspiration for your day, I don't know what I could do for you. What an inspiration. Dr. Carol Swain here on the Steve Gruber Show. We'll be right back.
Taking a closer look at the stories that affect you most with a big dose of common sense.
First thing I remember was asking Papa why.
All right. Continuing on down this road, trying to cover as much as we can with as much detail and context as we can. So many stories, you know, just the, as an example, the nomination of a Supreme Court justice, that'd be a lead story for 3 hours in normal times. You know, the battle for the White House, that would be a lead story in normal times. The rise of liberal fascism, trying to silence conservatives everywhere, that would be topic enough, but there's so much more, and it continues on and on and on. Our next story about the budget, as we continue to go down the rabbit hole, $19 trillion in debt and deeper, and no relief in sight, it seems. Our next guest, Paul Winfrey, director of the Thomas Rowe Institute for Economic Policy Studies at Heritage. Paul, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
You know, once again, here I am, and you know, one of the big angers with the Republicans is certainly the fact that, you know, they've won a lot of seats. They've won Senate seats and governorships and both at the state and federal level, and yet nothing ever changes, it seems, at least not at the federal level. Paul Ryan allows through a $1.1 trillion Cromnibus bill, furthering our debt. Nobody wants to pay a bill, and it's always, well, you know, I'll gladly pay tomorrow for a cheeseburger today type mentality, right?
That's exactly right.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, we saw the House Budget Committee mark up their annual budget last year, yesterday. They voted it out of committee around 7 o'clock last night, and it will probably go to the floor next week for a vote in the full House. But it's likely to fail, and it's likely to fail for two reasons. One, this is the first Republican budget since Republicans have been in the majority. Well, I don't know, maybe since Republicans have ever been writing budgets. It actually increases taxes. It would increase revenues by about $375 billion relative to CBO's baseline over the next 10 years. And the other thing that it does is it essentially would codify President Obama's discretionary budget for 2017. The discretionary number in there is the same discretionary number that the president requested for the upcoming fiscal year.
What's that number?
It's about $1.1 trillion.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
$1.70 billion.
So mm-hmm. You say this is going to fail or it's going to pass. I've got a couple of congressmen coming up here later on the program. So mm-hmm. I'm going to hold their feet to the fire, of course. Is this going to get through or it's not going to get through?
Well, it sounds like it's going to hit a lot of opposition on the floor. The Republican Study Committee, which is about 170 most conservative members of Congress, have come out in opposition to the $1.07 trillion number. And the House Freedom Caucus has also come out in opposition to it. It sounds like Paul Ryan and the rest of leadership are currently trying to cut some side deals to make all of those members feel comfortable. But from what I'm hearing, it's going to hit a lot of opposition, regardless of whatever side deals that they come up with.
Can I ask you something, Paul?
Sure.
I mean, do people in Congress, most on the left and a few on the right, or alleged right, did they skip fifth grade math class? I say it and it's kind of funny, but I mean, honestly, if you take in a dollar and you spend $1.50, and you take in a dollar and you spend $1.50, and you keep borrowing the 50 cents from the guy down the street, at some point the guy down the street's going to ask for his money back.
That's exactly right. You know, I wrote a couple of weeks ago that this is how a country goes broke. As you mentioned in the lead-in to this conversation, you know, the continued promises that we see from Congress is to just increase spending now with promises of savings in the future that ultimately never come. We've seen the same thing over and over and over again over the last several years. And one of the things that I found particularly peculiar about this budget is that they're just doubling down on that strategy. In my view, it's no longer reasonable to talk about aspirations in the budget. We need to, you know, really get serious now, cut spending now, cut taxes now, reduce the size and scope of government, and start passing budgets that reflect the principles of the American people, rather than essentially giving President Obama everything that he wants.
Well, it's not, but you know what? You, the fair point is Republicans are just as drunk on the cash as the Democrats most days of the week. Now, let me ask you something. Whatever happened to sequester? Whatever happened to that whole idea that we were going to mandatorily cut spending, get things under control? I mean, are we too far gone at $19 trillion? How do you ever pay off? I mean, I believe the new budget was it $4.4 trillion? The new, of course, we only brought in $3.3. You know, we brought in a record amount of money in the history of the world, $3.3 trillion last year, I believe. And we turn around and want to spend $1 trillion more than that every year. I mean, I'm sorry. it gives me a headache, or $800 billion more, whatever it is, it's an immense amount of money. How do we ever pay off $19 trillion? I mean, I'm willing to sell California today, but I don't know if we'll get $19 trillion. What are your thoughts?
Well, you know, I mean, what you got to do, first of all, is stop digging a hole. I mean, as you mentioned, if you've got a budget at $4.4 trillion and you're only bringing in $3.4 trillion in revenue, all you're going to do is just keep adding to the debt. And if you keep adding to the debt, your debt service payments are going to continue going up. Under the CBO baseline, if Congress were to go home over for the next 10 years, do nothing, they were literally just to go home and not come back for 10 years, we would be paying about $800 billion in annual interest payments by the end of the by the end of that 10-year period. Ultimately, that's just unsustainable. So the first thing that they've got to do is that, like I said, they've got to start digging a hole, and they've got to start getting serious about the financial course of this country. And one of the peculiar things that I found between this debate between the House Freedom Caucus folks and the RSC and House leadership is over whether to spend, in real terms, a 1% more than the last year that Bush left office, or 3% more than when Bush left office.
It's you know, I just sit here and I'm just dumbfounded by it all. I am. I mean, I listened to the people on the floor of the Senate in 2005 and 6 decrying the fact that we were $6 trillion in debt. It was unpatriotic, said Barack Obama on the campaign trail. And he has tripled that figure, tripled it.
That's exactly right.
And I just don't know. I mean, at some point, there is a point of no return. There has to be. And I don't know when we reach that, Paul, but, you know, if we don't get it together and soon, we will be selling California, or we'll all be broke. We'll have a debt crisis here. And what happened in Greece will look like a local carnival compared to what will happen here.
That's exactly right.
I'll give you 30 seconds for the last word on this whole mess.
Well, you know, one of the things that we are seeing is that there's some good news coming out of the Republican Study Committee. They're going to be putting out their own budget later today. It reflects a budget plan that looks a lot like what we put out a few weeks ago. It would cut spending by over $8 trillion over the next 10 years without increasing taxes. So, like I said, there is some good news, and hopefully the full conference can adopt that budget and like I said, stop digging the hole that we're in.
Yeah, and I believe in Santa Claus. but I do appreciate you fighting the good fight, Paul. I do, but I have...
You've got to remain optimistic.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, as always.
Thanks very much.
There you have it. Paul Winfrey from the Heritage Foundation. Back in a moment on the Steve Gruber Show.
Started with news from around the state and around the world. Common Sense Radio. This is the Steve Gruber Show.
In the rain. Bullfrog. Doing it again.
All right, welcome back to it. I mean, there's just so many stories. And we are going to talk about the Flint water crisis. The governor testifying a little bit later this morning, about just over an hour from now. We'll talk about that at 45 coming up, so in hour 3 you hear the program, so stick around for that. Right now we have to switch back, but like I said, in normal times, the nomination of a Supreme Court Justice, that'd be all day. A political race for the presidency, that'd be all day. Just this year is the most unusual news year of all time, really. My next guest, Byron Henry, legal expert and constitutional scholar. And let's talk about Merrick Garland and the implications for the Supreme Court. Byron Henry, welcome to the program.
Great to be with you, Steve.
All right. First of all, give me a thumbnail sketch of Merrick Garland in your estimation.
Well, in a nutshell, he is a distinguished jurist with an impeccable pedigree. He's Harvard undergrad, Harvard Law, both graduating with honors in both instances, editor of the Harvard Law Review. He was a prosecutor, U.S. attorney with the Justice Department, and involved in the Oklahoma City bombing case as well as the Unabomber case. And he's been on the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals at the federal level for the past 19 years. So basically, as far as a resume goes, it is about as good as a Supreme Court nominee can get. So other than the fact that he is a white Jewish male, which is not always something that this president or some presidents are looking for when they're making Supreme Court appointments. He's basically right out of central casting for a Supreme Court nominee and considered relatively moderate compared to a lot of the other choices that President Obama had on the table.
Well, you know, right out of central casting. Let me see. When Antonin Scalia died, correct me if I'm wrong, three members of the Supreme Court were Jewish and six were Catholic. Not one Protestant on the Supreme Court since 2010, right? And if I'm not mistaken, if Merrick Garland were confirmed, which I find highly unlikely, wouldn't that make eight out of nine, or would it be a clean sweep, nine for nine, that they all come from Harvard? Is there another law school in America that can produce a Supreme Court justice, or is that the only place?
I think there's three from Yale. I think we would be at a 6-3 split, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, for Yale versus Harvard. So I think
I'm going to have to go back and look. I think Ginsburg went to Yale, or she went to Princeton briefly, but she also went to Harvard.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And I'm going to have to look, but but here's the thing. If you're looking for, you know, representation of the country, you know, a Catholic certainly don't make up 2/3 of the country the way the court sat before. And if Merrick Garland were confirmed, the Jewish population certainly wouldn't take up nearly 50% of America. So it's an interesting makeup that you would have, four Jewish justices and five Catholics. It's just odd to me. Isn't that odd?
Yes, and there's actually been a call, of course, from a lot of people, or before the nomination was made, both on the left and the right, there were articles and calls for the president to appoint someone with more, I guess you would say, general experience in life and the law, meaning maybe someone that had been a private lawyer maybe for longer, maybe someone that hadn't spent their entire life in the executive branch or as a public servant. Not that there's anything, of course, to denigrate public service, but just someone with a different perspective than a lifetime public servant or judge or prosecutor.
I mean, aren't there any judges that graduated, say, from the University of Michigan Law School or Stanford that would be worthy to sit on the nation's highest court? That's what I think is bizarre to me. Roberts, of course, is from Indiana, but the rest, and Merrick could say he's from Chicago. He probably hasn't been in Chicago except for cocktail parties in years and years.
Probably so. And, of course, most of the federal judiciary are, for good or ill, especially at the top levels, are Ivy League educated, though Chief Justice Rehnquist and Justice O'Connor, when they sat, were both Stanford law graduates, so they haven't been replaced with anyone from the West Coast.
But, that's right, or the flyover states, for that matter. Now, speaking of Merrick Garland, he is a guy that would change the balance of the court. He is left of center by quite a bit. He's an anti-gun guy based on the two cases on point that are pretty clear, that he is not a Second Amendment supporter, which means they could go back and overturn the key Second Amendment decisions of the last few years, written by Antonin Scalia. So the pushback from conservatives is going to be intense because he's not a friend of the Constitution, they would say.
Well, let's look at it in two ways. First of all, I think the GOP in this case, the Senate, is not going to make it about Merrick Garland because they've said that there's not going to be a process because they're not going to hold hearings or interview Judge Garland, so there won't be a process with respect to a personal pushback on him, but you're exactly right. If there were any arguments on the right about Merrick Garland, they would start with two things. One, their concern for the Second Amendment rights, jurisprudence, and whether he would roll back individual gun owner rights, and the fact that because he's been in the executive branch, he seems to have a history of deference to regulatory agencies such as the EPA and presidential authorizations and presidential executive orders. So those two things would concern conservatives if there was going to be questions about his ideology. I don't think there is going to be because I don't think the Republicans are going to take up the challenge or the fight or take the bait and actually have hearings on the nominee.
Well, the fact of the matter is the Senate is not required to do anything. There is no time frame for it at any rate. In fact, they could leave that vacancy there for 10 years if they were so inclined, if the Republicans were in the majority, and they would still be under the constitutional right given them in the separation of powers and co-equal branches of government. Yes or no? I got about 20 seconds.
Yes, you're exactly right. The Senate has given its advice and that it's going to withhold consent, and at that point I believe they've probably discharged their duty under the Constitution and have no other obligation to move forward on this nomination.
So as long as Republicans hold 41 seats that won't budge in the U.S. Senate, 41 seats, that's all it takes to block the nomination, right?
That's correct. The filibuster rule, 41 seats can block any nomination to the Supreme Court if they hold.
Well, in a vote, if you have to have 60 votes to get somebody through, right?
That's correct.
Confirm somebody. Anyhow, Byron, good conversation. Greatly appreciated. And I'm sure we'll talk through this process again at some point because it's going to take a while.
Thanks, Steve.
Byron Henry, everybody, legal expert, constitutional scholar right here on the Steve Gruber Show.
This is Common Sense Radio. Straightforward and no excuses.
All right. Come on now.
This is the Steve Gruber Show.
Call me crazy.
Ooh, yeah.
What I said was perfectly right and spot on accurate.
Boy's got a mouth like a cannon, always shooting off.
Stop. Yeah, stop. I mean, you're way off script.
Got it in me. Gonna quit until it all comes out.
Hey, boy.
Yeah, you know, it's not cynical, it's common sense.
Pay attention to me when I'm talking to you.
I'm gonna rock the nation. Rock the nation.
Genuine, accountable, and raw. Here is Steve Gruber.
It is Thursday here on the program. In about an hour, the governor, Rick Snyder, will be in front of a congressional committee to discuss the problems with the Flint water. So that testimony coming today, as our testimony from the EPA and others, as that inquiry continues. We'll keep you up to rest on that. Also today, the budget being discussed for fiscal year 2017. Many saying it's not a serious budget because it doesn't tackle mounting debt and wasteful spending. What does Congressman Tim Walberg think? Well, we should ask him. Good thing he's on the line. Congressman, welcome back.
Hey, good to be with you. It's a beautiful morning here. The demonstration is beginning with community organizers and Al Sharpton here for a Flint thing. It's sad that they have to make it a political, partisan, and even racial event when, in fact, the people's eyes that I looked into last Saturday in Flint are people are just asking for help to get this thing fixed so we can have clean water for our kids and our families again. And so hopefully the hearing today, the third in a series, will be good toward that. But on the budget, that's
well, hold on. Let's start with the Flint. Let's start with Flint and the House Committee on Oversight of Government Reform Committee. Here, you're right about what you said. It's been turned into a political football about race and every other thing that has nothing to do with any of this. But, you know, far be it for Al Sharpton to miss an opportunity to be in front of a television camera spewing hatred and bile. It's what he does. He's a race profiteer and a race baiter. So that's what you get. But the bottom line is this. Flint has been trying since the 50s or 60s to get their own water supply. When they decided to do that, Detroit kicked them off their water supply, giving them 1 year to switch. And so that put them into a short-term crisis, caused them to switch water back, and then they didn't treat the water properly. The EPA dropped the ball. The DEQ dropped the ball. And the state government was slow to react, as was the federal government. But to blame it all on Rick Snyder, to say this is something racial or something, is reprehensible at a minimum.
I think it is. He'll have his chance to give his point of view today, and I'm sure that he will be questioned very, very significantly. And I think it'll be bipartisan. I'll be asking him questions. I know I'll be leading the questioning today. And my first questions will be for the governor. But I'll have some very significant questions for Gina McCarthy and why in the world, and especially some emails that came out yesterday after she did an op-ed piece in the Washington Post where she said the EPA was not part of the problem. They had no blame to share.
Well, of course they did.
That is absolutely asinine with all that went on there. They have the overriding responsibility. Certainly DEQ failed. But the city government failed as well. It was a failure all around. But Rick Snyder was in there trying to restore the city. This has gone on for years. Steve, there are 40. We were told Saturday by the city officials that 40% of their water leaks out of the pipes before it gets to their water system. That shows there's a major problem, and it ought to be an example for other cities around this country that you better be making sure that your elected officials aren't wasting money, taxpayer dollars, on things that aren't going to infrastructure needs that are most vital, such as clean drinking water. So these are all things that we have to look at. But to place a blame on someone who was trying to do the best for the city and got caught with some bad information from people that he certainly should be able to trust, and it didn't happen. But the federal government was not there when they were notified of the problem, and
well,
a whistleblower from EPA.
What I understand is that your regional director of the EPA, who is the person who was being reached out to most often, was too busy giving workshops and speeches on global warming. I mean, that you can go find that. I mean, they didn't care about Flint kids and the lead crisis in Flint. They're too busy. The EPA, the federal government, giving these seminars and speeches on global warming. I'm sorry, where are you? You're not manning the post. And again, you look at what happened. Flint has a federal obligation at the water department to put in non-corrosive agents into the water. You're also, by federal law, required to have a written plan to go with that. Neither of those things happened, so Flint violated federal law at least twice that I'm aware of. The people in Detroit got their feathers all ruffled up when Flint decided to leave, so the people in Detroit kicked them off the system originally. A lot of things happened here, and a lot of moving parts. And did the Snyder administration, were they slow to react? It would appear from where I stand, but to blame them, but to blame him and call him, you know, imply that he's a racist, targeting poor black children, is reprehensible.
Now, I think in this time and place, and especially now in Michigan, we've made some major turnarounds. We've seen Detroit rebound with a Republican governor and Democrat mayor working together, I think very closely now, Mayor Duggan and Rick Snyder. We've seen some revitalization takes place that gives us all sorts of hope. The economy in Michigan has rebounded to a greater extent, and I think it's because of sound economic policies that have been pushed forward, some very tough decisions by the state legislature, and that's, of course, where it's all supposed to happen, back in the states and the local communities. But when you have a federal administration like the EPA that is taking more responsibility than ever was intended by the Constitution, then they ought to at least carry out what they're mandated to do. And when I read in the testimony time this past Tuesday to Susan Hedman, the actual wording of the law that said that in any threat of imminent danger or a problem to the people, EPA was to act and to step in. They had all authority to do it. They didn't do it for a full, well, better than a year. And that's a great concern. So today ought to be an interesting hearing. Having the head of the EPA there to hear what she has to say. If she's going to continue to say it's all everybody else's problem, that will not be acceptable.
All right, fair enough. All right, so we have just about a minute now, a minute and a half left for the budget. Not a serious budget, according to many. Does not address the fact that we're $19 trillion in debt and so on and so forth. So give me an idea. Is it dead on arrival, or does it have a chance?
Well, I think it's suffering a bit right now. There are real concerns. The conservatives, we want to see continue to cut. Strategically, we also want to make sure that we put a proposition forward to show what could be done if we had a president who would sign. And if we have the opportunity to debate it both in the House and the Senate without filibuster, debate the issues, and the Democrats offer their amendments to increase spending, to increase taxation, and the Republicans, I'm certain, will be offering amendments to further cut. It might be a good strategic move to move something to the Senate that could start that negotiation. On the other hand, if we don't have assurances that there'll be at least a legitimate debate on the issue, then Republicans ought to show the fact that moving that figure up to 1070, rather than pushing back to what we had originally started with at 1004, under the original Ryan Murray plan,
right,
maybe the way to go.
All right. Well, we look forward to hearing your questions on Capitol Hill today, Congressman, and we'll follow up with you very soon. Congressman Tim Walberg, thank you very much.
Well, you have a great day.
You too, my friend.
Genuine Michigan common sense on display every day.
All right, welcome to it. It's the Steve Gruber Show on a Thursday. Quickly to the hotline, Tim on the line in DeWitt. Tim, what's on your mind?
Well, good morning, Steve. Earlier this morning, you were talking to an individual about the Supreme Court nominee.
Yes.
Just a couple comments. First of all, yeah, he's from Chicago. He was reared there during the Daley administration, so he has that. Yes, he's Jewish. But maybe the biggest issue is he clerked at the U.S. Supreme Court level. Do you know what justice he clerked for?
Brennan.
You know what Brennan is best known for?
Being wildly liberal.
Well, he authored one of the worst decisions in the history of the Supreme Court, Roe v. Wade.
Yeah, there you go.
He was the instigator of Roe v. Wade.
And there
yeah,
you
I
go.
Think he's there because he's. I think the reason he got it over the Hindu fella is because he is anti-gun. He is rabid anti-gun.
That's right. He is.
And if you look at the history, George Soros, who's a key figure now in world politics, he backed Obama. In fact, he was the first one that Obama went to see when he needed money, when he decided to run for president as a sitting U.S. senator after 2 years.
All true.
Guess who Soros is backing in this election?
No, it's all true. He's a Hillary backer. He's the one that's busting in the thousands to Chicago as well. Tim, thanks for checking in. Make no mistake, George Soros, the billionaire, is behind. They admitted it on MoveOn.org on Twitter after the Chicago incident with Donald Trump's campaign that people that are trying to blame Trump, when thousands of people are bussed in to create a riot, well, Donald Trump created this. How on earth did Donald Trump create a riot when thousands of anti-Trump people were bussed in on George Soros' dime? Come on, people. You're smarter than that. Quickly to Glenn and Dansville before we get to our next guest. Glenn, real quickly, what's on your mind?
Morning, Steve. I'm wondering if there, for this Supreme Court nominee, if there already isn't a fix in. I keep hearing the Republicans say that they're not going to have a vote on this or a hearing on this before the election. But what about after the election?
Well,
if they do it before the election, Trump is in a landslide. If they do it afterwards, what's the harm to them?
I don't know if Trump's in a landslide, Glenn. I get your point, but here's my point, and we'll get to our next guest on this. Steve Doolin is the professor here at Cooley Law School in Lansing and an expert on constitutional law. Steve Doolin, welcome back to the program.
Thanks, Steve.
Now, here's what I think. The reason to wait is, if Hillary gets elected, maybe you go ahead and confirm this Merrick guy, Merrick Garland. Maybe you do, maybe you don't, but it gives you an option in that regard. And if Hillary doesn't win the election, well, then you've got a chance to put somebody altogether different in there. But you're a professor at Cooley Law School. Your expertise is in gun law primarily, but you're well-versed on the Constitution in general. Tell me what your impressions are of Merrick Garland.
Well, I agree with one of the previous callers. He is certainly anti-gun. This would be disastrous for the Second Amendment moving forward.
Yeah, so, okay. Is the fix in? I mean, the caller there thinks that they're not going to vote on him because if they did, it would give an advantage to Donald Trump to win the presidency. I don't know if that's true or not true.
Yeah, that's more of a political question. I'll say this. Personally, I don't believe in conspiracy theories because my law practice has shown me that people are awful at keeping secrets.
Yeah, they're terrible at that. Yeah, okay, so go on.
So I, you know, as far as whether there's a political motivation for this beyond merely trying to save the Second Amendment, it maybe is the only answer I can give.
Yeah, all right. So if this guy or anybody like him gets confirmed to the United States Supreme Court, how difficult is it to overturn precedent on the court? I mean, the court has already ruled in a couple of cases that the right to keep and bear arms is, in fact, an individual right, like every other right in the Bill of Rights. It didn't magically become a collective right when the others are all individual rights. But, hey, I digress a little bit. What is the chance of it being overturned?
The chances of an outright of the court outright overturning the Heller decision is pretty slim, but it could be limited pretty severely. And, you know, the most... the example I use with my students is there was another case after Heller called McDonald that was about whether the Second Amendment applied to the states. Mr. McDonald has since passed away, but he was a lifelong resident of South Chicago. He was descended from slaves. He could trace his ancestry. And he had defended his house a couple of times, his home a couple of times over the years with firearms. And he was the plaintiff in the case that confirmed that Heller applies to the states. The McDonald case was actually filed very quickly after the Heller decision challenging Chicago's prohibition on owning handguns in the home. And that case went back up about 2 years later to the Supreme Court. That was by then Justice Sotomayor was a new justice on the court. And Justice Breyer specifically essentially raised all the same arguments he had made in the Heller decision, and it was another 5-4 decision. So the folks who voted, the folks on the court, the members of the court who voted against Heller, against the individual rights interpretation, basically did it again when it came to the McDonald case a couple of years later. That's how dyed-in-the-wool they are and how attached they are to this ridiculous collective rights theory. And so if
it doesn't hold water at all, constitutionally speaking, because there are no other, you know, collective rights in the Bill of Rights. The first 10 amendments, the Bill of Rights, are individual rights,
well,
God-given rights.
Clearly, and that was shown very clearly in Heller. There were dozens and dozens of amicus briefs filed by all kinds of groups, including members of the JAG Corps of the U.S. military, saying that this is clearly an individual right. The simplest way to explain that is it says the right of the people to keep and bear arms in the Second Amendment, and everyone agrees that everywhere else the word the people is used in the Constitution, the Constitution is referring to an individual right.
That's right. That's my point. The first 10 amendments of the Constitution are individual rights. You know what the problem is with you, Professor?
What's that?
I never have enough time with you.
Well, you know, I appreciate it.
Well, that's it. I mean, you know, you're a wealth of information, and I greatly appreciate it. I'm sure we'll talk more about it as we go forward, but I know that the Senate at this point is doing nothing. Professor Steve Doolin, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
There you have it, from Cooley Law School and Michigan Coalition for Responsible Gun Owners, Steve Doolin, the professor on firearms and so much more on The Steve Gruber Show.
The Steve Gruber Show, American values with Midwestern common sense.
No, it's a ballroom blitz, all right. You know, there's a free-for-all in the world of politics on the Republican side. And chaos being created by the left as well. MoveOn.org throwing millions of dollars to create big disruptions. And apparently we've barely seen the beginning of it now. Democracy Spring, the name of the group that's coming forth using George Soros' money to try to disrupt everything possible, beginning on April the 2nd, they say. Huge protests from Philadelphia to Washington, D.C., beginning April the 2nd. Nobody's talking about it on the major media, but a lot of other folks are. Largest civil disobedience action of the century, they claim, being funded by George Soros and, of course, those on the left. Meanwhile, on the Republican side, it's a bit of a food fight, too, to say the least. Michael Brickman here, Senior Project Director at Luntz Global Partners, to continue to sort it out. Michael, welcome back.
Yeah, thanks for having me back. And MoveOn.org, setting low expectations, as always.
Yeah, well, exactly. But you know what I find crazy, though? Like on ABC World News last night, a big expose on the violence at Trump rallies and da-da-da, and not word one about the fact that George Soros, MoveOn.org, on Twitter, took credit for putting thousands of people in Chicago last Friday and creating that whole, you know, disturbance, and not one word. Not one word. Isn't that crazy?
Well, and these things seem to only be helping Donald Trump, and whether that's intentional, I'm sure there are some on the left who think that he's the nominee they want to face off against Hillary. I'm not sure if they're correct or not. I don't think anybody knows, but it certainly does seem to be benefiting Donald Trump more than hurting him.
Well, it seems to me. Here's the thinking, and I believe this to be correct. George Soros, who spent, what, $15 million in 2004 trying to get George W. Bush out of the White House, complete failure, is coming back again. His belief, his game plan here, is to make Donald Trump toxic. And, you know, I hear people, oh, you know, Donald Trump's a raging, you know, racist. And so, what is that based on? Because he said that, you know, there are some rapists and murderers coming over the border because we're not checking who's coming in. It's proven to be true. We had a gentleman on the program here yesterday, an African-American man whose son was gunned down in front of his house, star football player, by an illegal alien in Los Angeles here a few weeks ago. Now a Trump supporter who says, now, wait a second, this is going on. My son was murdered, steps from my house, 17 years old, by an illegal alien because the kid was wearing a Spider-Man backpack, was on our program here yesterday. You know, and this kind of craziness. So maybe you have a better handle on it, Michael. Does all of this intentional attempt to make Donald Trump toxic, is it backfiring?
Well, it seems like in general, most of the attacks and the groups that we've done, whether you're attacking Donald Trump on substance or style, it seems like those attacks only serve to strengthen him. And I think this is the simple reason why. People are fed up with the political establishment. They are fed up with what's going on in Washington. And they are fed up with politicians who are not angry about the fact that so many Americans have it tougher today than they had certainly 8 years ago before President Obama, but even further back than that, where wages have been stagnant for a very long time, job creation is not fast enough, and politicians will give lip service to those types of things. But while they might see Donald Trump as overreacting, maybe being too bombastic in some of his rhetoric, at least in their mind, somebody is fired up enough, is annoyed enough to speak out in a way that sounds like the type of thing they've been saying for a long time, whereas most of the other politicians are speaking to the issues, but they're not angry about it because in the minds of many, this type of thing isn't affecting the political class. It's affecting regular people.
It's affecting everything, and that's why. Okay, so help me with this. Michael Brickman, we're here with us with Lunch Global Partners. Help me with this. Why are the Republicans so afraid of Donald Trump? Are they, if they're really afraid of losing, which I think their actions as of late contradict that, if they were really afraid of losing, wouldn't they have gone after Donald Trump and found a stronger candidate, you know, back in August or September of last year? Because the consensus from everybody I talk to, and I talk to a lot of people, if the Republicans try to play games with a brokered convention, or there's some discussion that they're now going to meet in D.C. for a secret meeting to run a third candidate, third-party deal of their own, so Donald Trump won't get the presidency. What the hell are they trying to do? I mean, are they so afraid of Trump getting the nomination, or are they afraid of him winning?
Well, it probably depends on who you ask, but there are certainly people in the Never Trump movement who are questioning why there weren't stronger attacks against Donald Trump back in the summer and fall, why he wasn't taken seriously earlier. And that's a question that I think people will be asking for a long time, whether you support Donald Trump or not. But the fact is, by many in the media, by many of his political opponents, he was not taken seriously until really the voting started.
And so what do you see now, Michael? You look at these statistics closer than probably anybody that I talk to on a regular basis. Everybody in the pundit world, in the chattering class, say Donald Trump has no chance of ever beating Hillary Clinton. And I'm sorry. You know, Kentucky had no chance of losing the national championship in basketball last year. Kentucky was inevitable, and apparently so was Hillary Clinton. But that's why they play the games, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think people who have underestimated Donald Trump so far have been proven wrong. Again and again, and we certainly are also guilty of not seeing this coming. I don't think really anyone did.
But when Hillary Clinton stands out there,
there's still debate on whether or not Donald Trump can even win the nomination.
Well, there is some on that.
Question about that.
You know, but it looks like he's got a pretty clear path. But when Hillary Clinton stands out there and says, we're going to put coal miners and mining companies out of business, you know, how does that play in Pennsylvania? Not very well. Or Eastern Ohio. Not very well. I mean, she goes out there and says, we're going to destroy mining. We're going to destroy coal companies. But you know what? We're going to send in some money to help you. Yeah, because a retraining program that pays 50 cents a week is what people want that have had real jobs for their whole lives. I mean, come on. That's a failed comment. And for her to say that, you know, we didn't lose anybody in Libya. I mean, there are some she is a weak candidate.
I have to agree with you. I think you look back over the last year, and hardly a week or two goes by without her putting her foot in her mouth. And unfortunately, if you're a Democrat, that's the candidate. She is very close to completely putting Bernie Sanders out of this. And they're left without another option right now, and yet Democrats, you talk to Democrats again and again, big Hillary supporters, you say, well, but do you trust her? Do you think that she is telling you the truth? And they can't bring themselves to say yes. And even when you ask Hillary about it, she can't bring herself to say that she's always told the truth to the American people. So I don't think even Hillary Clinton believes that she's telling the truth all the time. Yeah. So
I think
that
I've
is
told
a major,
truth.
Major problem for a major party nominee.
Yeah. I think I told the truth. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, that's what her answer. Yeah. Michael Brickman, always a pleasure. Luckily we've got months of this to go, you know, so it's good for people in your business and mine. So we got that going for us. We'll talk soon.
A lot of twists and turns still to be had. Thanks for having me.
You got that right. Michael Brickman from Luntz Global Partners here on the Steve Gruber Show. We'll take your calls after the break if you'd like to chime in. 888-900-9966. Your thoughts for the day. 888-900-9966. Don't be shy. Be somebody.
Genuine Michigan common sense on display every day.
All right, your thoughts now. Where is Dave in California when I have a chance to fillet him? 888-900-9966, 888-900-9966. I am in a filleting mood. Hey, if you're looking for a safe space, this ain't it. If you're looking for the free exchange of ideas, this is it. But you might be offended because we're going to tell the truth and hold people accountable. Steve's on the line in Lansing. Steve, welcome to the program.
And nothing but the truth, so help me, God.
Amen, brother. What's happening?
Anyway, I think the most exciting part of this campaign right now, when you listen to the Democratic pundits, is what's not being talked about. They've tried to really put the hush on the size of the crowds. Yeah, they had a crowd, and it's the report, the disingenuous reporting is incredible. You know, one side, everybody's there, and the numbers expand so much. The other thing that's not being talked about is the Trump Democrats. Or how do you want to put that? Reagan Democrats?
No, they're Trump
Reagan
Democrats.
Democrats.
No, there was a poll I just saw yesterday. I don't have it right at my fingertips here. 20% of Democrats polled said they would vote for Donald Trump. 19% of Democrats polled said they would vote for Donald Trump, Steve. That is a phenomenon right there.
I listened to Face the Nation Sunday morning, and I listened to Four Pencil Necks do everything except talk about the crossover vote. It's exciting. It's a wow. And I think also the days of the button-down starched collar with the Republicans, and you get this slack jaw attitude from what's his name, the Speaker of the House? Mr. Ryan?
Yeah. Anyhow.
You know, he is like a John Kerry clown, and it's done.
That's absolutely true. I got to run, my friend. Good screed. I liked it. Greatly appreciated, Stephen Lansing. Let's see. We got Ed on the line now. Ed, welcome to it.
Steve, love your show. Thanks for taking my call. A couple things. I'd love to know the Republican Party that's trying to take out the leading candidate of the Republican Party. Where have they been for the last 8 years while Obama has run roughshod over this country? And number two, they trot out all these losers that have made millions of dollars off of my back, telling me who I shouldn't be voting for when they're the ones that created the problem. So I think I've already made up my mind who I'm voting for. So
it sounds like it. Ed, greatly appreciate it. Appreciate you listening. You can join me on the air, 888-900-9966, 888-900-9966. Let's see, Roger, he's always got something to say from northern Michigan and the northern reaches of the network. Roger, welcome to it.
Yes, good morning. Thank you for taking my call. I've got a scenario here that I'm thinking about. How come the unions of America aren't out there in mass stopping what Hillary is saying about closing down the power plants, the coal-fired power plants, and the coal workers? My stepdad was a miner.
Let me tell you that. I'm going to answer your question here, Roger. Here's what's going on. The union leadership, like the AFL-CIO that's organizing with George Soros to try to shut down Donald Trump events, they are saying, hey, we have to, you know, we have to be with Hillary and so on and so forth. The rank and file, the people that are minors in places like Pennsylvania and Ohio and Kentucky, they will vote 100% for Donald Trump if he is the nominee, because he's the guy saying you can't do this. They will not vote for Hillary Clinton. I've had calls, personally taking calls, of lifelong Democrats saying to me in Michigan before the Michigan primary, saying, I don't know what to do. I can't vote for Hillary under any circumstance. And these are obviously not minors. They're just people looking at her. They realize she's anti-gun. They are people that believe in the Second Amendment. They're Democrats, lifelong Democrats, but they believe in the Second Amendment. They say, I can't support her because I know what she's going to do. She's going to take away my gun rights. So there are millions of people that are blue-collar Democrats that are not going to vote for her. This whole thing about Never Trump, you better watch Never Hillary. I'll give you the last thought here real quick.
Well, that's yeah, and our First Amendment that they're trying to, like...
no question.
Yeah, Mrs. Lynch is trying to do.
Yeah, they're trying to stand on our rights all the time. Roger, I got to bounce. And that's what they're doing. The little liberal fascists shutting down, you know, political events. They say that they're going to have the largest civil disobedience action of the century starting on April the 2nd. Here they come to shut down discourse, to demand drama in Washington. The radicals believe this will result in the arrest of thousands of their own activists. It will. And it will also portray them for what they are. Going back to the hotline, Joe checking in from Owosso. Joe, welcome to it.
Hi, how you doing, Steve? No, I think the interesting thing is when you just brought up the fact as a third, you know, party, is that I had said all along that even though Trump signed an agreement, I could see him doing third party. But the more interesting thing is, you know, we've always talked about President Obama turning us into Europe. Well, let's think about this. If GOP puts in a third party, Trump runs, Hillary, and then what would be hilarious is that if Bernie Sanders goes as a rogue candidate, then we really have Europe, don't we? Because then we have four different candidates.
You know what? I'd be all right with that. I would be all right with that. I'd be okay with that. Now, here's the thing. Trump, at this point, still has the inside track to get the Republican nomination. And there is this conversation, apparently, that there's some Republicans getting together to run their own third-party candidate to stop him. If that's true, what are they afraid of, Joe? That's what you have to consider. Thanks for checking in today. That's what you have to consider today. This hour of the Steve Gruber Show brought to you by the Michigan 529 programs, making sure your kids and grandkids get the education they need. To learn more, go to SaveWithMI529.com, SaveWithMI529.com. And that's what you have to ask yourself. If the Republicans are truly getting together in Washington, D.C., power brokers, big money people, what are they up to? And why are they doing it? Are they so afraid that Donald Trump will win? I mean, the only reason you would do it is because you think he's going to win, because you wouldn't run third party because you know that's a guaranteed loser. That's a guaranteed loser. So the question would then become, what are they afraid of? And I think that they might trigger a real movement towards Trump. I don't know. It's an interesting year, to say the least. I don't know where it goes. You know, meanwhile, Ted Cruz, he could still get the nomination, but he's going to have to muster his forces, that's for sure. Back in a moment on the Steve Gruber Show.